Hello and welcome to the final session of Architecture of the Edge 2020 Day 2 Boundaries. This evening we're joined by artist, architect, poet duo Kreider and Leary, and the presentation they're making is called Ungovernable Spaces: Lessons from Berlin and Belfast. Kreider and Leary are a poet and architecture duo, as I say, who collaborate to make performance, installation, and time-based media work in relation to sites of architectural and cultural interest. Since 2003, they have made work in places such as prisons, military sites, film locations, landscape gardens, desert environments, and more traditional gallery venues across the UK, USA, Europe, Australia, South America, and Japan. Kirsten is currently a professor in fine art at the University of Oxford, where she leads the Ruskin School of Art, and James is associate professor at the Bartlett School of Architecture, University College London, where he's program director for the MA Situated Practice Program. James and Kirsten, welcome to Architecture the Edge. It's great to have you here. I'm just going
Thank
to hand
you.
straight over to you
Thank you.
for your presentation this evening.
Okay, fantastic.
Thank you so much, Frank, and thank you for the invitation. It's really great to be here. It's an unfortunate situation that we're not in Galway, one of the most beautiful cities in the planet, I would say. I absolutely love Galway, so it's a shame we can't be there in real life, as it were. But we're sending greetings from across the pond here. So what we're going to do this evening is, I'm in one room and Kristen is in a different room, and we're going to hand back and forth across a partition wall over here. So we're going to be swapping back and forth, hopefully pretty seamlessly. So for those of you that don't know our work, I'm just going to take you through just a couple of our projects very, very quickly. So we like to work in a situated way. All of our projects basically are rooted in very specific locations and spaces. And this was one of the first projects we did together, which was in the women's prison in Cork for the European Capital of Culture. And we've worked on projects chasing Andrei Tarkovsky's sites in Bagno Vignoni in Italy, chasing certain scenes that he used in the film Nostalgia. We've been to certain locations in Japan trying to understand the concept of shake, the borrowing of landscape. And we also do different kinds of events and walks and so on, usually trying to engage very physically with the materiality of the place, also trying to excavate some of its histories and interest. And coming up to more recent projects, we spent some time in the Edge City of Lisbon with a project that we did here for the Triennale called Edge City. We've also made two publications. The first one is Falling, which we published in 2015 with Copy Press, and most recently Field Poetics, which we published in 2018. And Field Poetics tries to kind of gather together some of the writing that happens around these projects, the last five or so I've just mentioned to you. And more recently, we've been looking at sites for a larger project that we're working on called Ungovernable Spaces, of which we're going to explore more widely tonight. And we initially did a video piece for the Istanbul Biennial in 2016, based around the Belfast Peace Walls and interface areas. And we've got particular locations that we're interested in. You can see this main red line here to give you an example is the major, I guess, what most people would recognize as the major peace wall or peace line in Belfast, which goes from the Westling motorway on the right-hand side of the screen here, which is close to the city centre, and then literally you know, snakes along the landscape there all the way up to the edge of the Divis Mountain on the left-hand side. So you've got the falls, the Nationals Falls, on the southern side of this photograph, and you've got the Loyalist Shank Hill on the northern side. So this wall, or series of walls, or series of gates and walls, if you will, separates these two territories and has done so since 1969. So if over 50 years now, this wall has been in position, and it's one of over 90 different walls and barriers across Belfast, across the whole of Northern Ireland. They also have some in Derry and rural areas and so on. So we're pretty much focusing on Belfast tonight. And we're trying to also think about its relationship to the wall in Berlin and trying to see if we can learn anything from understanding what happened in Berlin and the process of the wall coming down, and trying to see if we can learn from that process and possibly apply it to Belfast. So the current project is really much wider. It's called Ungovernable Spaces.
And
Kristen, you're going to just talk about the principles of ungovernability and how we might live together.
Well, yeah, just introducing it at this stage. But so let us imagine a situation. Something new or different or unknown is introduced into the order of things. The initial response, or more accurately, reaction, is to contain this newness, this difference, this unknown. Walls are built, fences are erected, and the newness, the difference, the unknown is cordoned off until such a time as it can be processed, perhaps integrated, or found a place in the known order of things. But that is all in the realm of the abstract, the general, the realm of thought. In reality, in the realm of the particular, which is the realm of politics and ethics, we might recognize that this newness, this difference, this unknown is perhaps a movement of bodies across continents or water, a movement of people within societies and cultures, movements of bodies in and through cities, states beyond boundaries, movements that beg the question, the fundamental political question, how ought we to live together? Critically, as we see it, this question must be understood in relation to another, the fundamental ethical question, how ought I to treat another? In this way, our politics, the collective practices of our cohabitation, the means whereby we act in concert, necessarily arises from the principles and philosophies guiding our interactions and interdependencies, such that the we of the people can be understood to comprise contingent relations between singular beings, I and you. This, rather than the bounded identity structured through the opposition of us and them. These questions are central to each of the situations that we are studying in Ungovernable Spaces, and it is from this question that we move into other questions driving this project, including, what does it mean to be governed? What does it mean to resist? How does resistance find form? And how might this introduce something new, something different, something unknown into this world? Which returns us to our initial question, this time with a slight inflection. How do we learn to live together in this new, this unknowable world? So those questions,
Oh, sorry, Kristen, you were going to continue with this.
Just a very brief thing, just to mention the other ungovernable spaces that are in the project. So the first is a situation in Valparaiso, Chile, the open city, a radical pedagogical experiment started in 1971 by a poet and an architect, Godofredo Iommi and Alfredo Cruz. And we went to visit the site and did a site survey and some interviews and a kind of performance. And then we've written about that. The second site is kind of a practice. It's the Gandhi's practice of spinning and the accompanying salt march. And we're interested here in the everyday actions of spinning and how this fed into Gandhi's overall vision for a completely independent economic nation state. And likewise, the salt march as a more direct form of action that is part of his satyagraha, nonviolent activism. So we went to Gujarat and we traced Gandhi's salt march and we did some filming and some talking along the way, and we've written about that one as well. And then the third is the project with Belfast that'll be referred to today as James moves back and forth between Berlin and Belfast, and I sprinkle it with some thoughts.
Okay, so this is one of the peace walls in Belfast, again at Beverly Street, the interface there. This was a photograph taken in 2015. So you can see there, I'm just showing where the, you know, what era these photographs were taken, because we'll be moving through from the 60s, 70s and 80s right up to the present day. So to start, we'll just give you a little menu of what we're going to try and cover. We're going to move between a kind of a set of theoretical texts and then questions about Berlin and Belfast. We're going to talk about whether a Berlin moment is ever possible in Belfast. We're going to talk about the fall of the wall in Berlin, which used two errors and a flood of human beings. We're going to talk about the voluntary prisoners of architecture, the chapel in the death strip, no horizon and new horizon, and green archipelagos that might lead to a future Belfast. And in between, we're going to sprinkle the conversation with some writing that we've been doing around Belfast called 13 Points Expanded. So to start, a Berlin moment in Belfast. We've been studying this piece of territory now since about 2014 or so, and we've put together this thing called the Peace Wall Archive, which is an online archive that tries to document the history of the Peace Wall since 1969, their development from much earlier than that, going back to the 20s and 30s. It's available at peacewallarchive.net. And what's interesting is that we've been obviously going around and trying to systematically itemize and examine each of the different walls in all their individuality and idiosyncrasy. And the Stormont government has actually got this target of 2023 to remove every single peace wall in Northern Ireland. So they've got 3 years left now of a 10-year program that they announced at the time to actually remove every single one of these walls all across the north. And it's obviously not going to happen. That's the first thing to say. but what's clear is this kind of refrain that we've encountered wandering around, which numerous people have said. And this refrain are the words, "You'll never have a Berlin moment in Belfast, never." And I'm curious about how this statement can be made with such certainty, you know, that there could never be a Berlin moment in Belfast. And I'm just, you know, wondering why, to a certain extent, and maybe that it is actually possible. So you can see all of these different types of walls. There's a whole load of different, you know, eras of walls, heights of walls. Some are more transparent than others. And you can see that they're scattered all over the city in a really discontinuous way. So it's not like there's a single wall continuously moving from east to west or north to south. They actually appear and disappear and start and finish, and you turn a corner and you have a huge thing and then it just kind of disappears. It's a very, very strange system. But it's a system really designed to separate and to control. And of course, They go to absolutely huge heights and completely block off any kind of visual access between one side of these barriers and the other. So last year in 2019, I actually put together this conference, which was trying to mark 50 years of peace walls in Northern Ireland, since the first one was built in 1969. And this photograph here shows the wall on Kashmir Road, which started off as a piece of barbed wire in 1969 in September, on the 10th of September, actually. So we marked it on exactly the day of the first barbed wire going into the ground in Belfast. And the question of Berlin moment, could it ever happen? So let's just try and look at the situation in Berlin and try and maybe do a kind of comparison between the two to a certain extent. So unlike the walls in Belfast, the wall in Berlin was a kind of continuous, even though it changed in material properties and size and scale, and also changed in its materiality over time. It also started off as a barbed wire wall, then became a block wall, then was risen and high. Then they made these concrete paneled wall sections, which are probably what most people are familiar with now. But what's interesting, it actually went right down through the center of the city and cut off areas like Wedding from Mitte, for example, the Tiergarten from the center of the city, Kreuzberg from Friedrichshain, and Neukölln from Treptow, and so on. So although the wall actually went from north to south, roughly speaking, in the center of the city, what's interesting to note is that it actually continued right around West Berlin. So in effect, it formed a kind of circle rather than, a partition, as it were. So the whole of the city of Berlin obviously is located in the east. So the West Berliners were in effect prisoners to a certain extent within this large wall system that was, West Berlin sat within. So this is where I'm going to try and actually look at a particular moment. And let's see if this is going to work for me. This is actually what happened.
be a storm wind. Then we ring the freedom bell for peace of mind.
So just let this play a little bit. Wonderful scenes in 1989 in Berlin. And what's curious is that the fall of the wall actually happened as a result of two kind of mistakes in a way. Although there was a lot of pressure coming from the East with perestroika and glasnost and so on and changing attitudes in the USSR. What happened was the GDR, the Eastern European, or sorry, the Eastern German government were very reluctant to actually go along with Gorbachev's kind of initiatives. So what they had tried to do was organize a set of leniencies to do with how people could move between East and West through the wall, as it were. But what was curious is that they had scheduled a press briefing, a live televised press briefing by the GDR Politburo, and they were announcing these more relaxed rules for people to go back and forth between East and West. And the person, the spokesperson, Gunter Schwabalski, I think is his name, he simply got this piece of paper and read it out, and he misheard what was actually being said or written down. And he basically said that the gates of the Berlin Wall were going to be open pretty much immediately. And the press that were there at the time questioned whether that was actually going to happen. And he said, yes, as far as I know, immediately. So everybody saw this press conference on the TV, and they all kind of flooded to the points of entry and exit through the Berlin Wall. So that was some of the scenes that you just saw there, was like this huge flood of humanity from Eastern Berlin going through the gates, and the GDR patrolmen who were there simply just allowing the barrier to open because it just could not contain the amount of people that were there. So that was the strange circumstances of the wall actually coming down. It was because this live broadcast and the strange circumstance that led to it happening. So let's just rewind back a little bit and try and look at each of the walls, one which went up in Berlin in 1961 and the other which went up in Belfast in 1969. And it's worth noting, you know, you can see the scale here of the Berlin Wall versus the major Peace Wall on Cooper Way in Belfast. And of course, the Belfast ones have been up for much, much longer now than the Berlin Wall was in existence. And you can also compare it to other walls like the Palestinian Wall, the Israel-Palestine Wall. And of course, there are other walls and border walls and all kinds of boundaries popping up all over the world at the minute. But what's curious is that, you know, all of these major pieces of control infrastructure, they start as a piece of barbed wire on the ground. Very, very, you know, it's not inconspicuous, but it's a very small start to something that would start to take on such an important role in dividing the city. So here you can see the steady, I suppose, growth and division. I mean, these are East and West Berliners completely shocked by the fact that they lived on opposite sides of a street, and now they're actually living in two completely different jurisdictions, as it were, when before they could just move freely back and forth. And here you get an idea also, as they're building up these concrete blocks, of the wall actually, you know, meeting other pieces of architecture and using those pieces of architecture to become part of the wall. Mm-hmm. So it had this strange mishmash quality that over time they tried to kind of iron out and make the wall a much more seamless entity. But certainly in the 60s, you had this really curious quality to it, that it would be a certain material and condition in one place and built of certain materials, like these concrete blocks, for example, were another method of building. So these walls just went up overnight in August the 13th in 1961 in Berlin. And of course, the effect was that, you know, if you look over Potsdamer Platz, which is now this really dense part of West Berlin, it made huge kind of swathes of barren land in the city that just became like the edge conditions against the wall. Whereas previously these would be more central places in the city, because now the wall was dividing through the city infrastructure. It creates this really barren conditions on either side, this kind of, you know, terrain vague, as it were. And also splitting down along the lengths of streets. This is 1968. You can see the wall is rising steadily. There's barbed wire. And then by 1981, there's a much more systematic way of building with wall panels with these rounded tops that run, you know, right from north to south through the city. So this is photograph is taken in Kreuzberg. And of course now cut to much later, this is almost like a current condition. And this is in Bernauer Straße, where was one of the major lines of Berlin Wall for a while, which is now, obviously the original wall has been completely demolished and they have replaced it with this much more porous indicator of where the wall used to be. So this is now part of the Berlin Wall Museum in that part of the city, which is this outdoor area where, you know, people go and try and understand what happened with the wall, its impact on the city. So, yes, I just want to go back and hopefully we can see now turning to Belfast around the similar time. And we'll look at the state of the city. I mean, when we talk about the conditions that were created by the wall in Berlin, this is the state of Belfast.
One feels on seeing the open sore of Belfast for the first time.
In
for
the
anybody,
60s.
It's an unforgettable experience. For another Irishman, it's choking in a way that only someone brought up on a diet of heroes and history can understand. Whatever romantic notions you had, whatever childhood ideology about a united Ireland, turns sour in the face of this ghastly inhumanity. Although it's probably the starkest human situation you've ever seen, you're dazed by the unreality of it all. One minute you're riding along in a Saracen armored car, knowing that out of all this great city of Belfast, the vehicle you're riding in is a target for gunmen, booby-trap bombs, even Russian rockets. That's not fanciful. It's happened, and it continues to happen. Next, by yourself, you're walking along the dreaded Falls Road, where death is never more than a whisper away, half protected by the thin fabric of neutrality accorded to the journalistic profession, even by the gunmen. You can't see them, but they know your every movement, who you are, what you're doing here, even where you're staying. The danger is a thing you can feel with a sense you didn't know you had. It's a prickly, light-headed awareness. It suddenly occurs to you that in a strange kind of way, you're excited by it. But it's the kind of excitement that makes some people laugh at news that's just too awful to grasp. You see street after street of bombed-out, bricked-up houses, and the thought occurs to you that it never looked as bad as this on television. You look inside and see that the living room, where whole families, maybe 10, maybe 16, were born, grew up, and died, is only 8 feet by 6 feet. And you remember the army officer who said that if he was born in conditions like these, he'd probably have been in the IRA himself. Half-remembered public house arguments about the best solution to the Ulster problem echo derisively around your head as you walk across the peace line, a mile of corrugated sheets, brick walls and barbed wire that uncomfortably keep two strongly Christian communities from spilling each other's blood down the Shankill Road, and half-remembered childhood hatreds of redcoats and black and tans as you're searched by a British soldier. But there's no hatred now, of all the unfortunate people in this sorry city, he's risking most to gain least. All you're left with as you walk around is a lot of disjointed mental cameos, little crystallized observations that say small things about a situation where big things are impossible. Like the man in the Belfast pub, oblivious through much familiarity to the crouching soldiers with their rifles around the door, who told me, "The big killer now, you know, is white bread. They've taken all the wheat germ out of it."
Okay, so I will leave that there. And that's obviously from an RTE journalist. I think it's interesting, this kind of air of incredulity that the piece is delivered in, as somebody who's obviously come up from Dublin, or somebody certainly from the Republic, having a look at Belfast for the first time. And here's some of the spaces that he was walking around at the time. This is actually on the Falls Road side of Conway Street, and you're looking down towards what is Cooper Way and onto the Shankill, and you can see these very slowly developing divides between these two territories, and there's a kind of no-go area in between, which you saw very, very clearly, I think, in that piece of footage. So again, between these two areas in 1969, because there was so much conflict and civil strife in the area, in 1969 it was decided by the Stormont government to actually put what they termed a peace line between these two areas, which again started off as this barbed wire in stakes in the ground, and was dutifully mapped out through certain streets where they had to negotiate where to actually place the peace line. And in a very similar way to the Berlin Wall, the materials start to become more robust over time. So this is even in late 1969, when they realized that there was possible to throw missiles over the barbed wire. Very soon you had this corrugated metal system, which by the 80s, you know, had turned into a much more aggregated, you know, kind of ad hoc, add and lengthen and heighten over time. And of course, now in this area where, you know, this is the same location as that very first shot of the barbed wire, you have a wall that is kind of insanely, ridiculously high by any kind of measure. So again, it's important to note that, you know, these things are not continuous elements. They are discrete, they're separated, they're fragmented, they start and stop. And they're very much tuned to very local conditions of conflict and so on in the city. So, Kristen, you are going to go on to Carson for the first of the 13 points texts. And I'll go a little bit quicker. I think that was a nudge.
It was just sneakily put like a little time.
Okay, I hear you.
Carson. A droplet falls and swerves, marking the birth of a political event. A confusing turbulence follows, becoming civil war. Elements now polarized congeal and crystallize into bodies seen marching or fleeing from a street on fire. Families are displaced, decay and decline. A burnt-out bus between the Falls and the Shankill Road severs connection through vernacular divide. All of this, or something similar, will happen again. The vortical logic will hold. The pattern will repeat, each time with a slight variation, each time leaving behind a wall. Meanwhile, on the hill overlooking the city, a figure stands with feet spread and arm raised, an oratory gesture in apparent stasis that solicits elusive unity. A bird flies overhead. Emissions rise from his fingertips like the wisps of a fog.
Okay, so moving on to this condition in Berlin, moving back to Germany for a little bit, and returning to this idea of, you know, the West Berliners were in effect imprisoned within their own jurisdiction. They were perhaps voluntary prisoners of this architecture. And it's really interesting, around this time, 1971, a very famous and well-known architect, Rem Koolhaas, actually went to Berlin while he was studying at the AEA to do a field trip. And while most people were looking at temples and so on along the Mediterranean coastline, Rem goes to Berlin and actually decides to look at and analyze the Berlin Wall as architecture. And this was a really seminal moment in his own kind of evolution, really. And I mean, it's his term, like the voluntary prisoners of architecture was a title of the project that he actually made when he returned to the AA using the material that he got from the Berlin Wall. But what's interesting, if you look at the maps of the time, you know, this would have been a map from East Berlin. Literally the whole of West Berlin was just completely erased from maps, like it didn't actually exist. So this was the zone, in a way, of the voluntary imprisonment. So Koolhaas at the time finds the wall an incredibly fascinating artifact, which he almost treats like as a kind of, you know, with a kind of archaeological fervor in a way. So he says the wall functioned as a vast system of ritual. It was a script, effortlessly blurring divisions between tragedy, comedy, and melodrama. In its short life, it had provoked and sustained an incredible number of events, behaviors, and effects. From daily procedures, you know, the rudimentary day-to-day activities, to deadly global standoffs of geopolitical standing. And he says the greatest surprise was that the wall was heartbreakingly beautiful. And of course, this around the time he was there, these conditions is what he was looking at. And if you're familiar with Wim Wenders' film, The Wings of Desire, he very much floats around these interstitial areas on the edges of the wall. And you have certain characters who are trying to find parts of the city that they were familiar with that have been completely erased following the Second World War. So Koolhaas goes back to London, and then with Madelon Wiesendrop, Ilya Zengeles, and Zoe Zengeles, puts together this now quite famous project called Exodus, or the Voluntary Prisoners of Architecture, where the wall becomes a condition of freedom by self-imprisonment. So you actually enter into this controlled zone, in a way, where you're voluntarily segregated, and people find shelter within the walls of this kind of prison of a metropolitan scale. So this is like a really dark take on possible future conditions around the wall. And actually something similar was, in a way, going on in Belfast at the time. Moving back now to Belfast, you've got the map here with the Lagan and the docks on the top right-hand side of the map. And the city center of Belfast at the time was actually what was called a ring of steel, where you had a complete security cordon around the center of the city, and you had checkpoints going in and out. Then you had a new motorway which was being built around the city, causing huge dereliction and massive areas of completely demolished buildings, which again you saw in that piece of footage. And then beyond this area, in this outer kind of crust, were these completely left behind working class areas, including the Falls and the Shankill and so on. So you really have this condition of being outside of this kind of central area, but somehow being, in a way, almost like imprisoned within your own kind of enclave, your own home place, as it were. So, you know, as you're wandering around Belfast, even now, you get these really strange conditions where, certain photographers have obviously been attracted to the wall. There's lots of books of photography around the Peace Walls. But I think it goes without saying that at times they do appear to have like a kind of fortress-like or prison wall kind of appearance, with also lots of attendant security, monitoring, CCTV cameras, controlled zones, barriers, checkpoints, and so on. But what's interesting to note, I guess, is that more recently, some of the walls, through local kinds of negotiation and lots of very hard work, I think, behind the scenes by community groups and government agencies, some of the walls very, very slowly have started to come down. And what's interesting is that like these photographs are taken a couple of, I think maybe 2 years apart from one another, but once the wall comes down, the sense of the whole city opening up to the horizon is so impactful and so profound. I can't really tell you, you know, it's really kind of amazing. The amount, the change in light and just the sense of feeling and belonging part to a much more extensive city once these walls have come down, I think is really marked. And I think just very interesting. So Kristen, we're going to go to fantasy figures.
What does it mean to say this wall is alive? It means that this wall is not dead. It means that this wall has a life. It means that this wall is a life, understood as pure event. It means that this wall is alive as a philosophical concept containing only virtuals, made up of virtualities. Off of Springfield Road, there's a wall painted with a number of fantasy figures: Superman, Wonder Woman, Batman, Catwoman, Flash Gordon, two or three others. Each figure is an active force, shattering bricks with a necessary violence, exploding away through the wall. And behind each figure, through the wall, skies are bursting with orange and yellow rays. Buildings scrape the skyline in pink-purple silhouette. If it is true that some love the wall while it is standing, it is also true that others will love it only after it is gone.
So we're now going to jump back to Berlin, to Bernauer Straße, to a very particular site, which in its changing over time is, I think, very fascinating. Here is the Church of the Reconciliation in Berlin, which in the early 60s was actually, in a way, imprisoned in the Death Strip. So you can see directly in front of the front door here is the Berlin Wall on Bernauer Straße. And around it is this whole control zone of what became known as the Death Strip, which was surveyed by towers and so on periodically along the length of the wall. And then you have a double wall behind. So it became completely unusable over decades in this location. And in 1985, the GDR, after years and years of negotiation, just suddenly decided to completely demolish the church through a controlled explosion. So they completely demolished this church and its tower and spire and everything else, collapsed to the ground. So what was interesting is that the pastor of this church, Manfred Fischer, he became a real advocate. You know, this loss of this church was obviously felt really deeply, but in the rush to demolish the wall in 1990, he was one of the first to actually say, we can't actually get rid of the whole of the Berlin Wall. We need to actually hold on to parts of the wall to ensure that the same mistake is not repeated again, you know, as a kind of place of education in a way. So, yes, he has this oft-repeated saying, in order to grasp something, there must be something to grasp. So he was a real advocate of holding on to parts of the Berlin Wall that were there as educational opportunities. And he started advocating to rebuild the Chapel of Reconciliation in that area, but also critically to build a documentation center for the Berlin Wall and its history in that area in Bernauer Strasse. And almost miraculously, now this is what that exact same site looks like. It's a completely open green area in Berlin, a completely open air park with maps. You can see that it is parts of the original wall, parts of this newly made porous wall that indicates where it was. And you can see that along this whole length of the city is this extended kind of landscape of particular events and pieces of architecture. There's a documentation center, there's a rebuilding of part of the wall, there's the rebuilt Chapel of Reconciliation. And this is what the chapel now is a much more modest thing, but it is absolutely beautiful piece of work in that the rubble of the original church was actually stored and retained. And they use the rubble of the original church to build these new tamped earthen walls, which are just filled with the debris of the previous church. So there's a really beautiful kind of transmutation going on. And they also hold, you know, parts of the church in there as certain relics in the altar. So I think there's some really interesting lessons to be learned from this one particular strip of ground. So now back to another point in Belfast.
Wall is a single point expanded. There is more than one wall in this place. Around every wall is an environment, and at certain times, say in periods of unrest, we who inhabit this place expand. That is, our sense of self or ego expands to fill the entire environment. We individuals, our sense of self expands beyond the boundary of our skin, and in this way, the environment becomes thick with emotion, thick like fog, or like smoke billowing up from each individually lit fire. After the fires on Clifton Park Avenue, they erected a dense stratification of concrete foundation, concrete block, profiled metal sheeting, mild steel angles, scaffold bar, razor wire, metal palisade fencing, and roller spikes. Over time, these materials have changed, and more recently, the heavy, opaque constructions have been replaced by a lighter, more candid fencing. Perhaps one day, these all will be retractable, like the one on St. Matthew's Court, with its potential to be not a wall. Perhaps even later, sometime in the future, all of the walls will degenerate into mere geometry, a simple line. But whatever its material, the idea of wall will always remain. For generations now, there has been nothing in the world more important.
So we're briefly going to talk about green archipelagos, again, moving back to Berlin. It's interesting that Kuhlhaas, who we talked about earlier, while he was in Berlin, met with Oswald Matthias Ungers, the German architect, and together with Peter Reimann, Hans Kolloff, and Arthur Ovaska, produced this really interesting kind of master plan for the city of Berlin as it stood at that time, including all of these areas of fallow ground, which they called the city in the city, Berlin, a green archipelago. And they were really focusing on certain built up, very urbanized areas within the city. But then they wanted to focus on these urbanized areas and really allow everything else in between to kind of go back to nature, as it were. So they focused on these very specific urban islands, but then they allowed everything else to go back to nature, becoming a natural lagoon, as they described it. So you would have these very, very distinct and discrete pieces of architecture, and then between them, this kind of fallow ground. I think there's an interesting question there when we're thinking about Belfast in its current condition with these quite vast areas of open space in the city and how one might actually tackle them over the next, say, 50-year period or so.
So I was going to read a little bit, but I'm aware of time. So I'm just going to kind of gloss this section and try to pull out what might be the salient point as we move into the final section, talking about this future Belfast. And this section was basically kind of trying to give a sense of what the ungovernability is inherent in the ungovernable space. And to get a sense of that, there's another figure that we present, and this is the figure of Kybernetes, who's the helmsman or steersman, the gubernator when it's translated into the Latin from the Greek. And the helmsman or steersman is, I've never sailed, but it's the one who is basically kind of holding the ship steady while all of the kind of currents and pressures are pushing against the rudder, and you've got the atmospheric conditions around trying to pull everything off course. So this is the figure that's kind of listening to the feedback, and that's where the word Kybernetes moves into the word cybernetics, for kind of a notion of feedback into a system or an ecology. But if we understand that figure as a figure of the art of governing, and we kind of move a little bit through a kind of Foucault paradigm, I suppose, of thinking about the art of governance and the idea that everything is power. So everything is power. It's not that there's a state that has power and there's a people that resist. Everything is a power dynamic. And all of our kind of interactions and relations are kind of resistances, acts of resistances with that power. But it's all in play. So there's not a sense of polarity as in one and another. The polarity of lots of different points in tension. And when we're kind of moving into the notion of ungovernability, it's trying to think about those tensions and struggles and relations as a kind of dynamic that could allow newness to emerge, allow different patterns and habits and ways of being together to emerge. And if you take that and extend that, you can see how maybe those habits and patterns and ways of being together are infrastructural and move into the infrastructural. And then maybe how architecture either allows for that and maybe affords that. And then one of the things that we were doing in this Belfast project specifically is trying to think that it's not just people that have the agency in all of this, but that there might also be agency in the walls, in the materiality. James, you've been talking so beautifully about all of the different kind of components of the walls in each of these situations. So maybe that kind of gives a sense of the idea that the ungovernability inherent in governance is something, phrased differently, it is in and through the ungovernable that we can begin to emerge new world orders. So back to you, James.
Okay, so to finish, we're going to speculate about possibilities of a future Belfast. And we're going to maybe posit that the Berlin moment was not actually this opening of the Berlin Wall in 1989. But the real moment of significance is this much longer work, this period of transition from an area of death strip to an area of open air museum, with all the kind of strategic thinking, forward planning, finance, collaboration, and so on that went into that endeavor. So we know that walls are coming down in Belfast, but they're coming down very, very slowly. And that's primarily because there's a resistance to this kind of top-down governance. That's very clear when you sit in rooms like this. It's very clear the sentiment is that there's a divorce between the local people and their thinking and their communities on the ground and the Department of Justice that's overseeing the removal of the walls. And this is a kind of interesting indication. This is a published piece of documentation from the Department of Justice, where the community engagement section is literally completely disengaged from the whole process of wall removal. So we've been thinking, is it possible to actually, you know, think very carefully and strategically and holistically and in a kind of collaborative way between top down and bottom up types of governance, in a way, to be able to govern upwards as well as be governed downwards, so to speak. And we're thinking about a condition over a 50-year period, because, you know, there's no way things are going to happen in between now and 2023 to remove these walls. And in a way, what we're doing is, like Manfred Fischer, questioning whether all of the walls should actually be removed, or whether some of them should be retained in a similar manner to actually become educational tools in the city. And what we've tried to do is look at the adjacent spaces around the walls and to try and think about new kinds of uses and interesting adjacencies that might be productive. And then over time to reduce the walls completely and in a way be left with these new pieces of architecture and architectural fragments. So we've been carefully looking at all of the different gates and connections, you know, between the falls and the Shankill, trying to look for opportunities of stitching, reconnecting the city, perforating through the walls in certain areas, opening things up, and trying to see what the potential is in this particular space. And looking in quite close detail at the existing urban fabric and the urban grain to see what the kind of potential is here over a much longer period of time. So these kinds of plans are you know, underway and being developed to try and see what are the opportunities that might happen in relation to the peace walls, but also thinking about the much deeper history of the site. For example, these blue areas are the mill ponds that fed a lot of the mills in this part of the city, going back historically during the times of the linen mills. And it's also the River Farset drains and fills all of these ponds. This is the river from which Belfast gets its name. So part of this proposal is to try and reclaim and resurface the river as an open space in the city, and to actually completely re-green and plant a kind of urban forest, a green lung, from east to west along the length of the peace line. And over time, you have a series of pathways and landscape areas developing that are very adjacent to the current peace line situation and allow you to kind of interface and examine the walls as almost like a kind of archaeological artifact in the city. And also, you know, looking at the potential for overlooking, getting different points of view over the situation to help you try and understand it a little bit more closely. And also resurfacing the river through a set of rills, which, you know, might flow through this particular landscape and also allow for particular moments of play. So that over time, you know, pieces of architecture might start to become attached to and perhaps overwhelm the wall itself, so that what feels very large and substantial now could actually become, you know, cocooned within this much larger architectural framework and become a kind of object or artifact that you might see in a museum-like condition, for example. And that's current speculation, which is underway. And we're going to finish with the underground wall, the very first wall in Belfast, which was built to separate Catholic and Protestant graves in the city cemetery.
A popular legend speaks to the origin of the Red Hand of Ulster. The Kingdom of Ulster has no heir, so rival chieftains hold a boat race to decide who will rule. Whoever's hand touches the Irish shore first will be made king. And when it becomes apparent to one of the chieftains that he's losing the race, he cuts off his hand and throws it to the shore, where it lands first, a bloody sign of sovereignty. Another origin. The Belfast City Cemetery is built in 1869 between the Falls Road and the Springfield Road. Serving as a burial ground for the city's growing population, the plots are divided into Catholic and Protestant areas. These areas are separated by a wall sunk into the ground 9 feet deep. And every day, and every year, and every decade since, the soil around the wall has been moving and shifting, its particles tilled and sifted by countless little mounds. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
James and Kirsten, thank you very much. That was an absolutely phenomenal presentation. Really beautiful, actually, and sort of, there's so much there. It's very poignant, I think, some of the poetry, along with the images and the archive footage is something to behold. But I feel, in the context of the other talks that have happened today as well, it's a great way to finish day two of the weekend. We're at the kind of midpoint, but this idea that we're at the midpoint of the wall in Belfast, perhaps in another 50 years, that it's not just accepted that this is something that is part of everyday life. But you've also presented this alternative, which I suppose, thinking about Aisling Rusk's talk this morning about, finding these liminal spaces and moments, which I think your proposal for retaining these elements of the peace wall and sort of also connects with the talk that we did this afternoon about Sandy Road, that it was Agustina Mortier from Queen's University in Belfast. Mm-hmm. She's actually talking about the value that can be found in places that you might think there's nothing there, but even in these edge conditions or these nowhere spaces, that there, if you actually look and search, there are things that exist and that are of value. So the old mill ponds, I think that particularly stood out for me. That it's not just all dereliction and brownfield and waste. But that sort of stitching that you talked about as well, that you mentioned. But and then the church in Berlin that was sort of built from the rubble of the older one. So it's, some very beautiful things can arise or grow out of these things. And I suppose in the times that we're in at the moment, which are very testing, we're all sort of voluntary prisoners that we find ourselves in these conditions. we're meeting remotely, and hopefully you can come and visit us in Galway at some future stage. But that within all this, there is sort of a sense that people will find a way to come together and kind of and get through these little cracks and find the common things that bind us rather than the differences. At the very beginning of the talk, the Berlin moment did seem very joyful, and even watching it, we get caught up in the music myself, and then the footage of Belfast, it sort of seems, it is shocking, even now. Mm. But it seemed, how could you ever, find unity there? But I think it's these little pockets, these little moments that, the experiences on either side of that wall or that fence, when you take it down, suddenly there's the horizon there. Mm. And I think that slow moment, it might take another 50, but there's certainly a slow unfolding, which I do feel is happening. I think what you've presented is certainly going to play a part in that. So I want to thank you for what you've shown, and it's It's great. Thanks very much. I don't know if we've got any questions from other people that are attending. We're sort of run over a little bit.
There's a question from Emmett. Should I bring him in?
Yeah, let's invite Emmett in. Emmett Humphreys is the senior executive architect in Galway City and actually gave the presentation this afternoon about Sandy Road and started off talking about the city walls of Galway.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Is he there?
Hi, guys.
Hi, can you hear Emmett.
Me? Emmett, yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. Yeah, well, first of all, thanks a million for the presentation. It was absolutely fantastic. I went to school in Dundalk, so I was very close to the border. And I would have been very familiar with being in the north. And I suppose the thing that really hit me was the diagram that you of the mapping of the walls. It's so... how do you say, complex, the idea that these walls do not join each other, where, you know, in Palestine or Berlin, that's what a walled and a separated community is, not when you see it in Belfast. And the thing that hit me really was the way that architecture can unveil these situations and diagram and communicate them so clearly. And then you see how Boris Johnson and the Brit exit discussion is so fragmented into a very clear narrative of this is, we do this, we do that, out actually understanding or being able to communicate to a wider audience. This is the complexity. But what you two guys did tonight was to make a very complex thing understandable. And I just wish that we could bring that discussion into a political form to help negotiate out the discussion. That's the question. Can we use this research to be more useful in our political life?
Well, I think.
So when when are you running for Prime Minister? I think that's the question.
No, I mean, I don't think there's any diagram that could fully unpack the whole Brexit fiasco that we're kind of encountering here at the minute. But I mean, I think more locally, you know, the work that we're doing, we do have a hope that it's going to have some sort of impact, you know, if only to kind of start a conversation around, you know, what might happen in these places in the future. I think that's kind of very important. I mean, I feel like the whole conversation around the peace walls has almost been kind of swept under a giant carpet, you know, somewhere in Stormont recently, because you really, you know, if you go to Belfast, you can go into like a travel office or a tourist center, and there will not be a single thing there about the conflict or the troubles or the peace walls or anything else. But despite this kind of blanket ban on talking about it, there are hundreds of people every day in taxis being shuttled up and down to look at the peace walls in the city. So people are genuinely fascinated by what has happened in this place. But somehow it's not acknowledged as like a valuable cultural heritage artifact, in a way, a giant urban scale artifact to learn from, to ensure that this kind of thing doesn't happen again. And I mean, I've been up to Stormont and I've been into the Department of Justice. I've talked to people who are involved in the Interfaces program, and they're all really wonderful people, but it's such a really, really difficult situation to unpack up there at the moment. I mean, there's very few architects or urban planners involved, I think, unfortunately. I mean, I have offered my services, but they've been politely declined. So I don't know. I mean, I hope we will try and bring some sort of clarity to the situation, but also through the website, we hope it's a resource where you can actually see the impact of what these barriers through the city, what they do to these adjacent areas. which, you know, are by any metrics you could use in quite a disturbing state in terms of education, unemployment, you know, all kinds of different metrics. They're usually registering on the, you know, at the very lower end of any area in the UK. I don't know. I think the German model and the Berlin model I find is really inspirational because they genuinely did put resources into it. They thought about it very carefully. They put a strategy together. They put a document, you know, that was about, you know, a 30-year duration in planning. And it's all come to pass. I mean, it's quite astonishing feat of German organization. And I find that incredibly inspiring. So hopefully some of that mentality will arrive in Belfast sometime soon. I think do just a little touch more of it, as much as I love the place as it is.
Yeah. Thanks very, very much. I think that's a good place to leave it for this evening. It's an absolutely beautiful piece of work. I think it's relevant and important, and I think shares Emmett's sentiment that it certainly needs to be widely shared and sort of considered. Just want to say thank you, Kirsten, for your beautiful poetry. I think that question you asked at the very beginning about, you know, how we ought to treat each other, or what sort of, how can we learn to live together in this new, unknowable new world, is you know, the question I suppose we're all asking at the moment, isn't it? We'll leave it there, and that's
I think it's snack time.
Thank you very much. So. Yeah. That's there, so that's obviously a sign.
Take it away, Mishka.
Thank you again.
Thanks very much.
Yeah. Thank
thanks,
you very much.
We'll talk to you soon.
Thanks for being here, Susan Elliott.
Thank you.
Ian Lennon. Bye.